So today, welcome to this Gita discussion, and we are discussing about the prospects of growth in spiritual life and the challenges in that growth. Well, this is specifically one question. What happens if I am not spiritual enough by the time I die? So that is we'll discuss this based on 640 in the Bhagavad Gita. So Krishna is speaking here. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. पार्थ नैवेह नामुत्र विनाशस्तस्य विद्यते नहि कल्याण कृत कश्चित् दुर्गतिं तात गच्छति. सो पार्थ ओ अर्जुन न एव इह न अमुत्र. इह इज इन दिस वर्ल्ड, न इज नॉट, एंड अमुत्र इज इन नेक्स्ट वर्ल्ड, नीदर इन दिस वर्ल्ड नॉर इन द नेक्स्ट वर्ल्ड. विनाशस्तस्य विद्यते, देयर विल बी डिस्ट्रक्शन फॉर दैट पर्सन. Who is that person? Nahi kalyana krit kashchit. That one who is engaged in auspicious activities. Kalyana krit kashchit. Durgatim tata gachati. Not only will there be no destruction, but there will also not be any poor destination, inauspiciousness in that person's life. Tata gachati. Tata is a very affectionate form of address. So Krishna is assuring Arjuna that you are dear to me and there will be no destruction for one who engages in good work or auspicious work. Now, in the context of the Gita, good work here, kalyana krut, auspicious work, doesn't refer to charity or benevolence. Here it specifically refers to the auspicious work of getting out of the entanglement of material existence. The auspicious work of rising to spiritual consciousness. This is Krishna's first verse in answer to Arjuna's question, which was there in the previous three verses. And that question was, what happens to a person who embarks on spiritual life but is not able to complete that journey? So the question of our class is the question that Arjuna asks. And what the verse we are discussing is the answer. And it's a very reassuring and hope-giving answer. That never will there be destruction for somebody who is engaged in auspicious work. So now, let's try to link this with the flow of what we have been discussing till now. The Gita starts with the understanding of the question about what is dharma. And then we discussed various aspects about how that understanding that we are a soul and on a journey of spiritual evolution, how that is to... That understanding is applied in various areas of life. And specifically in this sixth chapter, Krishna talks about managing the mind so that one can transcend the world. So, in the previous session, we discussed specifically about how the mind causes problems in relationships and how those relationship issues can be dealt with. And when we discussed that, so the point there was that that means once one learns to manage the mind, one can get joy not only internally but also externally, socially. So then the question comes up that actually learning to manage the mind, to make it equipoised, is not easy. So Arjuna asks two questions. First is, he says controlling the mind is very difficult, the precise question which we have asked, which I mentioned. And Krishna says, yes, it is difficult, but if you strive, it's possible. If you strive with an appropriate process, it is possible. Then that assures Arjuna, but still so there are two verses to Arjuna's question, 633 and 34. And 35 and 36 is Krishna's answer briefly. But then Arjuna asks question, okay, you are saying it's possible if it's with an appropriate process. But what if I don't complete it? What if, say, it's like a chronic disease and before the treatment can work and cure me, what if I die before that? What if I run out of time? Now, we are talking about the treatment not of the body but of the soul. So, will whatever I do go waste? And Arjuna's specific question is not just that what will happen to a person who is practicing spiritual life and is incomplete in that. His question is a little more specific. He gives a beautiful metaphor of clouds, and he says that there are broadly, if you consider two clouds in the sky, and sometimes there are small, we may use the word cloudlets, or just globules of clouds, cloudy particles. And now, suppose one small cloud or a cloudy particle, cloudy lump, leaves one cloud and goes to another cloud. But while it is going toward that cloud, suddenly a stormy wind comes and sweeps it away. Then it was neither in this cloud nor in that cloud. It's lost. So Arjuna asks, similarly, so he talks about two clouds of people over there. One is, two clouds, there are two groups of people who are on two different trajectories. So one is the pious materialists. Krishna has talked about these earlier in the second chapter when he talks about those who practice spirituality, who practice some level of dharma to get a better material life in future. So they want to go to heavens or they want to get better worldly enjoyment. And so that is the crowd, that is the cloud, which is basically the crowd of pious materialists. And now there is a cloud of spiritualists who are not interested in going to heaven, they are going interested in going to the spiritual world. Now, in the Bhagavad Gita's understanding, heaven and spiritual world are two separate things. Heaven is temporary. Whereas the spiritual world is eternal. And we'll discuss about this a little bit more. But the question is that there's two clouds, and if somebody is wanting to become among the ranks of the spiritualists, but that person leaves the path of pious materialism, religious piety, and wants to go to the level of spirituality, but in between that person's mind is so restless that the mind sweeps that person away. In the mind a storm comes and yoga chalita manasaha, manasaha, the mind is restless and one goes away. So what happens to such a person? So basically, what if one doesn't succeed in spiritual life? That is Arjuna's question. So let's look at the session, what we are going to discuss today. Can we go to the next slide? There are three parts we'll discuss. See, in general, in any endeavor that we make, there is a fear of failure. That's the first part. Then we'll discuss about specifically what happens if there is failure in spiritual life. And then lastly, we'll discuss about how do we deal with the fear of failure in spiritual life. Let's begin. Let's look at the fear of failure. So this is a fear which stops us from doing worthwhile things. There are so many people who might have some talents and they could do some things, but they never do it because, you know, what if I fail? What if I don't succeed? What will people think of me? Now, one way to, in general, deal with the fear of failure is to think that at the time of death, we won't regret so many things that we did, which turned out to be failures or turned out to go wrong, by the things we never did, fearing that they might go wrong. See, all of us have certain talents, certain abilities, certain aspirations. And unless we strive, we will never achieve those things. So for most people, our regrets center on not being courageous enough to do something enterprising, to do something worthwhile. So now, the same fear of failure, which is there in, at a normal level, we deal with the fear of failure. See, in many ways, the principles for success and failure that apply in material life and spiritual life are similar in many ways. Because ultimately, one has to be courageous, one has to be dedicated, one has to be visionary. But it's just that which direction is one seeking that success. So courage itself is not so much the absence of fear as the presence of a purpose bigger than fear. Let's say, for example, when somebody... there are soldiers in the army. The soldiers in the army, it's not that they have no fear of death. If they have love for their country, if they're patriotic, then the point is that their love for country, then the purpose of wanting to defend their country gives them a higher strength. And then that helps them to overcome the fear. Just like now in the current COVID crisis, say if there are medical care workers, care providing workers, now they are, it's not that they are not afraid of getting infected, they are, there's the fear is there, but there is a purpose. You know, I want to help people who are sick, and how can I help them? It is by offering them the service that I am meant to offer them. So it is a purpose bigger than fear. Now, how do, so this same principle will apply in our spiritual life also. So if we have to deal with the fear of failure, we need to consider that I am striving for some purpose that is bigger than this fear of failure. So what could that purpose be? We'll look at that. Can we go ahead? So understanding what that purpose would be is what we will, how a purpose in spiritual life transcends our failures. That's what we will discuss now in the next part. Let's go ahead. Now, when we talk about spiritual failure, what are the possibilities? There are broadly three possibilities. In the Bhagavad Gita, here in this section, so this section which we are discussing is from 637 to 645. So one is that we run out of time. Run out of time means we are practicing spiritual life, we are trying to develop love for Krishna and we want to attain Krishna, but I say before we have become pure enough to develop love for Krishna, we run out of time. That means our body has a particular time duration which is determined by our past karma, and that time duration gets over. It, like we are having a rented car, the body is like a rented car, and we are meant to go to a particular destination. But before we reach the destination, the rental period of the car runs out. That's one possibility. We run out of time. Let's look at the second possibility. That somebody feels that this spiritual life is too challenging, I cannot do this. And then that person returns to material religiosity. See, Arjuna was never an irreligious person. Arjuna was a virtuous and religious person. Krishna is taking Arjuna from a religious level to a spiritual level. So now the second possibility could be that somebody is pious, virtuous, religious, and they give it up to, they rise from there to the spiritual level, but they are not able to sustain the spiritual level. And then they return to the level of material religiosity. That's the second possibility. That means somebody just goes back and starts living the way they were earlier. Now this possibility is there in today's time also, but in today's world, most of us, if we consider our lives before we are practicing bhakti, it is not that we were necessarily living a religious life. We might have been quite an irreligious life, doing many kinds of anti-spiritual materialistic activities. So somebody goes and falls back to material irreligiosity. So there's a, that means that person was doing many self-destructive kind of activities earlier, and they gave it up when they started practicing bhakti, but somehow they give up the practice of bhakti and then they fall back to self-destructive activities again, once again. Let's fall back to material religiosity. So there are these three possibilities, and let's see how these three possibilities are addressed in the Bhagavad Gita and other wisdom texts. So the Bhagavad Gita basically addresses the first two. Why? Because for Arjuna, the third is not relevant. Arjuna was never materially religious, and Arjuna was not going to fall to that level at all. But that possibility is discussed in the Srimad Bhagavatam, and we will come to that. So let's move forward, looking at one by one. So if somebody runs out of time, then what happens? Go ahead. So that person will resume their spiritual practice in a spiritually favorable setting at another place. So basically, in one sense, for the soul, the body is like a home. And if earlier I talked about a car, suppose somebody is on a particular journey and their car rental period runs out, then what happens? Well, they just hire another car. So like that, this person will get another car, another body. Now, here Krishna says that if somebody has already been practicing spiritual life very seriously and they have already quite advanced spiritually, they have no worldly interests, but it's just that when we practice bhakti, slowly our desire for Krishna and our attraction for Krishna increases. And for attaining Krishna, our desire for him needs to be greater than the desire for everything else. Ideally, we have no desire for anything other than Krishna. But if we don't have that, at least our desire for Krishna should be more than the desire for other things. But if one has not come to that level, but one is seriously striving to come to that level. Then Krishna says, one will be born again in this world. Athava bahunaitena. Athava yogina meva. Kule bhavati dhimatam etad didurlabataram. Loke janmayati drusham. So he says, that is the second possibility which Krishna is giving. The first possibility we will be discussing a little later now. So, athava, otherwise, yogina meva, these people who are yogis, kule bhavati dhimatam, this is 642 in the Bhagavad Gita, they will be born in the family of very wise people, in a dynasty of those who are dhimatam, whose intelligence is very developed. Here Krishna is talking about those whose spiritual intelligence, those who have spiritual intelligence. Etad didurlabhataram loke janmayadidrusham. And he says such a birth is extremely rare, extremely rare. So now what is the advantage of being born in a spiritually minded family? Because then right from birth itself, or even before birth, one's parents will be praying for one's not just material well-being that most parents desire and pray, but parents will be praying even for one's spiritual well-being. And they will be doing some spiritual ceremonies. They call it samskaras in Sanskrit. And then the child is born, the child will be given spiritual impressions, and in that way the child can grow nicely. So now this is a very auspicious birth, Krishna says. I give the car example. Another example would be, to say, if a student is in university and a student is coming to graduate, maybe, you know, maybe half a year is remaining. But if the student gets transferred, parents get transferred, and then the student has to go to that new place, then what happens? The student will get an admission in that university at that particular place. The student doesn't have to start from the first year in graduation. Just wherever the student is, from that level, the student can continue and graduate. So it's like that. Krishna says, even if somebody dies, the death will only transit them to another level of reality where it will be very favorable for their spiritual growth. And that's how the person gets elevated and liberated. Can you go to the next slide? Now, if somebody prefers material religiosity, what does that mean? That means that person feels, oh, this spiritual happiness and this is quite difficult to get, and I want material pleasures. Now here, this is not irreligious material pleasures. That person wants to follow the codes of ethics, the code, be virtuous, and thereby get worldly pleasures. It is said that we'll be discussing about heavens a little later. But the idea is that those who do good in this world, they will get good results. If you do materially good things, then we'll get materially good results. So materially good results means a person can get gets lots of worldly pleasures in this world as well as in a higher level of reality in the heavens. So if somebody prefers that, then what happens? Krishna describes in this next section. So they will get abundant material enjoyment till they become satiated, and then they'll get a materially comfortable position to resume their spiritual search. So the example for this could be that, suppose there is a university student, but that student gets caught in playing sports, but he's not abandoning the university and just playing on the streets. He's playing for the university. Then what happens? If the student is practicing very seriously and professionally, then the university may say, okay, you may not have to give your exams. You can suspend your studies for now. But you can go and play in professional level and whatever, play for the university, and then come back, and then whatever classes you have missed, you can pick them up, and then you can continue your studies. So this is something similar, roughly. If you consider the heavens to be like a playground, then a person who desires, so the world, the universe is like a university, and we are trying to graduate in this university and attain ultimately knowledge of Krishna and love for Krishna. But if somebody doesn't do that, is not enabled to do that, then why? Because they want to play. They want to play in the heavenly planets, enjoying various things, but within the precincts of dharma, within the boundaries of virtue. Then Krishna says, yes, they can go to the heavens. Prapya punya kritan lokan ushitva shashvati sama shuchinam shrimatam gehe yogo brashto bijayate. So he says, what happens over here? That person will go to the heavens. Prapya punya kritan lokan. Normally, to go to heavens, a person has to acquire a lot of punya. lot of virtue, lot of punya refers here to material pious credits, has to do a lot of virtuous deeds. But even if a person is not able to do all those virtuous deeds, still that person can get elevated and liberated if that person is stays on the spiritual path. But how will it happen? In this case, a person is trying to grow spiritually, but then they get attracted to worldly things. And they'll go to the place where they want enjoyment. They get that enjoyment, and then after that, they'll be born in this world in a family which is either wealthy or learned. So Shuchinam Shrimatamge, hey, cultured or wealthy family. Now normally in life, when we face challenges, there are broadly two challenges, financial and relational. So, and each of these challenges can completely consume us, and in our own lives we'll see if we are trying to practice spiritual life. If we have job anxiety or something, then we can't really focus much on spiritual life. Or if a relationship is important, is breaking down, then also focusing on spiritual life becomes difficult. So broadly, Krishna is saying that if somebody is practicing spiritual life, they go to the heaven, they enjoy over there. So whatever desire is there, that gets satiated. And then they come over here. And if they are born in a cultured family, then they have basic relational skills, and the relationship problems won't be there so much for them. And they are born in a wealthy family, then financial problems are not there so much for them. But either way, what happens? The struggle for existence in the world is not much, and they can focus on spiritual growth. And in this way, they can grow spiritually. So this is a second way. This is 641. So 640, which is the verse for our class today, 640 Krishna gives the assurance that they will not be lost. Whatever we do in our spiritual growth, we will never lose that. Now Krishna is explaining thereafter, how will we not lose that in these two verses? So 642 says, if one has run out of time, 641 talks about one has other desires. Now broadly speaking, an underlying assurance that Krishna is giving is that whatever we do spiritually, it's never lost. Normally, whatever we do materially, it gets lost. Somebody might be a millionaire in this life, but after they die, all their bank balance is left behind, and they go empty-handed, and they are born in the next life empty-handed. So our spiritual credits go with us. Our material wealth, whatever we earn, no matter how much we earn, it won't go with us. So now let's look at the third possibility. Can you go ahead? Fall to material religiosity. Then what happens? That person gets there is a material consequences for the actions. So when somebody gets a material consequence, what does that mean? Say for example, somebody gives up the practice of dharma itself and starts going back to something which is adharmic. So then what happens? Whatever we are attached to, that's what we get. See, the basic principle of transmigration, of when we leave our body to when we go to the next body, what is the principle? The principle is that what we are attached to, we are given a facility to experience that in our future life, so that we can work our way through those desires. Now, how would that work out? So in the Srimad Bhagavatam, there is a story of a great king, Bharat Maharaj. Now, Bharat Maharaj was very attached. Bharat Maharaj was a very evolved soul, sorry, not attached, very evolved, very detached. And at a young age, he renounced his kingdom and he started focusing on spiritual growth. But unfortunately, while he was focusing thus, he got distracted. While he was in the jungle, he saw once a she-deer was pregnant and she was being chased by a predator. And she jumped across a river to run away from that predator. And while she was running away from that, we were jumping across the river, in her fear and the strain, she had a delivery, and the baby deer fell into the river and the stream was flowing away. So being swept away. So Bharat Maharaj was sitting in meditation, but he had opened his eyes and he was observing, and he saw this deer getting swept away. He just ran, and then he started rescued that deer. Now that was good. That's normal human compassion. If somebody is drowning, you save them. But what after that? Unfortunately, he got attached to that deer. He started thinking that I have to maintain this deer. what happened, the deer, the mother deer, she, because of the fear and the strain, she actually died. He said, this baby deer has no one to take care, I have to take care. And then he gave up his sadhana, and he stopped. When he went to chant mantras, he was watching at the deer, playing with the deer. And one day that deer disappeared, and he desperately started searching everywhere for the deer. And while searching for the deer through a hilly area, he slipped and fell, and he was severely wounded, fatally wounded. And as he was desperately in pain, looking around, and that deer appeared in front of him. He was already attached to that deer, and he was thinking of that deer, and he saw the deer also. So thinking of that, thinking and looking at that deer, he died, and next life he became a deer. So there was a consequence at the material level. So because he was attached to a deer, he got the body of a deer. So similarly, if somebody does something wrong, then they will get some consequence of that. Now in this case, it was not an impious activity that he did, but the point was that he got deviated and he got a deer's body. So sometimes somebody might, so there is a, so in the Bhagavatam, in the third canto, there is a verse, Aho bata shubchoto gariyan, yad jivhagre vartate namatubhyam, te pustapusta juhu sasnur arya brahmanuchur nama grunantiyete. That those who are low-born, if they are chanting the names of Krishna, then that means they have already done various pious activities in the previous lives. Then the question comes up that, you know, then why are they low-born right now if they already had done a lot of spiritual activities in the previous life? The understanding is that they did something wrong in their previous life because of which they got a low birth. But despite their low birth, the spiritual inclination is not lost. And here there are two distinct principles to understand. There is a material law and there is a spiritual principle. And these two can go on a parallel track. So material law means that, say suppose, now normally in a bhakti culture we take milk, we take milk products. Suppose somebody is lactose intolerant. And somebody says, you know, this is food that is offered to Krishna, that is prasad, this is auspicious. So let me take this. Now, because it is prasad, it will spiritually purify that person. But if their body is material lactose intolerant, there will be a material reaction to that. So then if they have a material challenge like that, then better they don't take that food, they can take some other food. So similarly, so there is, things will act at a material level. There's a material law that will act, and there's a spiritual principle. The spiritual principle is that taking food offered to Krishna purifies. But at a material level, there will be material reactions. So we have to be careful of both things. And we have to be, so now what happened is, it's a material principle that if one gets attached to something, one will attain that state in the future life. That Krishna will talk in the 8th chapter, and we'll come to that in due course. But the principle here is, that it is a material principle. If we do something wrong at a material level by the law of karma, there are actions, reactions to those actions. So the material and the spiritual go in parallel tracks. So although there was a material reaction to Bharat Maharaj's action and he got a deer body, but he did not get the consciousness of a deer. Even in a deer's body, he remained aware of his spirituality. He remembered his previous life and he knew, oh God, okay, this I got deviated in my last life. So he did not spend his life as a deer, frolicking around, fooling around, just trying to find some grass to eat. He would stay near the hermitage of the sages, and whatever he would get to, whatever grass he would get nearby, even if it was dry, he was satisfied with that. And he focused on associating with the sages, hearing spiritual sound vibrations, the Vedic mantras recited by the sages. And that's how we continued spiritual evolution. So that means our spiritual credits will never be lost from us. But if somebody does something materially short-sighted or materially destructive, there will be a reaction to that at a material level. But what happens is the spiritual credits remain. And those spiritual credits draw a person toward Krishna, toward the Lord in that life. And in the future life also. So basically, this is described repeatedly in scripture. So when you talk about spiritual credits, what does it mean? It essentially means an attraction to transcendence. It is, so suppose somebody might be born, say suppose somebody is reborn on the earth, so we try to practice bhakti, but we are not able to complete our bhakti practices and we are born somewhere else. Then what will happen? We may be born in any part of the world, maybe that part of the world is God forsaken. But what happens? If we have cultivated attraction toward God, then that attraction will be there within us. And that attraction will be latent. And it will draw us toward transcendence. Purva abhyasena tenaiva riyateya avashopi saha. Krishna says, almost helplessly one will be drawn toward transcendence. So, Bharat Maharaj lost his material position, but he did not lose his spiritual disposition. His attraction toward the Lord remained, and that was special. So we will never lose anything, we will not lose our spiritual credits, but what we will lose is, if we might lose some time. How much time? That depends on how much we get deviated. If it just we run out of time, then we don't really lose much time except the time for transiting from this life to the next life. But if somebody has worldly desires, then they lose the time that they need to work through those worldly desires. But if somebody has a lot, not only worldly desires, but they also do some inauspicious karma activities that involve some bad karma, then they'll reaction for that also. And then they will undergo those reactions, and then their spiritual journey will continue on from there. So basically now when we say the spiritual attraction remains, where does it remain? That's like all of us have various degrees of knowledge. So we can speak certain things, there is articulated knowledge. Then there is embedded knowledge or embodied knowledge. Embodied knowledge means just like with respect to gestures. Now, if you said small children are playing some games, now some children, when they're playing their games, if somebody doesn't follow a rule of the game, hey, you can't do like that, you can't take that piece, you can't move it here. You ask, why can't I move it? What exactly is the rule over here? No, you can't do that. Why can't you do that? They might not be able to articulate it. So if we consider circle of articulated knowledge and a circle of embodied knowledge. Embodied knowledge means we know what to do. So just like language. Now we say, if English is our first language and then somebody speaks something wrong, now you don't use that word like that. Now why can't I use that word like that? Now we may not specifically know the grammatical rule why this is not done like that. So we don't have that articulated knowledge, but we have the embodied knowledge. This is spoken like this, this is not spoken like this. So what happens? For us, if one circle is our articulated knowledge, another bigger circle is our embodied knowledge. So, it may not be that for somebody, for a child who is newborn, even if that child is a greatly evolved spiritual soul from a previous life, it's not that the child will be born, when the child is born, instead of crying, the child will start chanting some sacred mantras. No. The child, there is the material principle that may act, but what will happen is, the child may not be able to articulate, but child will be spontaneously attracted. And there are many devotees across the world, when they have children, they find that the children are naturally very spiritually inclined. It could be that those children are already spiritually evolved souls. And that's how they are getting attracted toward Krishna. So that's possible. So basically, the spiritual credits that stay with us and they draw us toward Krishna, it is not that if you have memorized verses of the Bhagavad Gita, in the next life you will remember the verses itself. No, there will be attraction to a transcendence that we will remember. Maybe not the verses themselves. So, after we bear the material consequence of that particular action, we will resume our journey in an appropriate position. And then, as I mentioned, the deer in his next life became Jada Bharat. He became a very evolved spiritualist, completely detached from the world, and he focused pinpointedly on spiritual growth, and ultimately he attained the spiritual perfection. So that's how, what Krishna says, one will never attain inauspiciousness. That principle is demonstrated over here. Go ahead. So the point is, even if we fail, we can fail well. So this is the conclusion of the second part, not the conclusion of the class. We can still fail well. Fail well means that if we just strive at our level to develop a spiritual connection and a spiritual vision, then even if we fail materially or spiritually, we can fail well. Go ahead. So now with respect to this, how do we get that confidence? Now Krishna says this, but still we may have, there's natural fear of death, and we'll talk about death and fear about death in future also. But at this stage, whenever there is fear of death, what will happen to me after death? Even if I'm practicing spirituality, where will I go? What that fear is there? So what can give us the assurance that the fear of failure in spiritual life, which is there, which can be because of death, which can be because of deviation before death, how do we overcome that? So broadly, I'll talk about three things for this, and this is the last part of our class. Go ahead. So three parts. The soul's longing for transcendence is inextinguishable. Krishna's love for the soul is inexhaustible, and the opportunities for using our free will properly are interminable. Let's look at each of these points. The soul's longing for transcendence is inextinguishable. Can we go ahead? So, inextinguishable means that the soul has a taste for transcendence, and the soul can never be satisfied in anything other than Krishna. This is a theme that comes across various religious traditions. In the Christian tradition, Saint Augustine says that, O Lord, thou hast made our heart for thee, and our heart finds no rest till it rests in thee. So the idea is the heart will never find rest in anything else. We might crave for various things, we might slave for various things, we might get those things, we might enjoy those things, but afterward, immediately we'll want something more. So the Bhagavatam in 1.5.19 states that, Navai jano jatu kathancha navrajen mukunda sevyanvayadanga samsmitim smaran mukundangrya upaguhanam punar vihatum icchan rasagraho jana. So, says that if somebody starts practicing spiritual life, and then Navai jano, certainly not jano, jano is those people, jatu. At any time, kathanchan avrajen. So if somehow or other, kathanchan, somehow avrajen, they give up spiritual practice, then they won't go back to ordinary materialistic life. Mukunda sevya anvayad anga samsmritim. Samsmriti is material existence. They won't go back to giving the lotus feet of Mukunda. They won't go back to ordinary material existence. Why not? Smaran mukundangrya upaguhanam punar. They will remember the lotus feet of Mukunda. Upaguhanam punar. And because of remembering the lotus feet of Mukunda, vihatum icchen na rasagraho janaha. Rasagraho. That taste for Krishna will remain, and that taste will drag them, draw them again and again toward transcendence. So the taste lasts. So that means we might temporarily be allured by worldly things, and we may go toward those worldly things, but soon we will be drawn, oh, this doesn't fulfill me, I need something else, I need something better. And the search for something better will again draw us toward Krishna. So if we feel that the world's temptations are too alluring, and maybe I can resist it today, but tomorrow I won't be able to resist it, then why resist it today also? No, just do what we can. Even if we get deviated tomorrow, Krishna will draw us back to Him, because the taste is inexhaustible. Can you go ahead? Then beyond that, it is also not only that, our longing is inextinguishable, but also Krishna's love for us is inexhaustible. That means even if we turn away from Krishna, Krishna doesn't turn away from us. Krishna stays with us and tugs us, pulls us toward Him. So this is described in the Bhagavatam in the prayers of Gajendra. Madhruk prapanna pashupasha vimokshanaya muktaya bhuri karunaya namo layaya Swamshena Sarvatanubhran Manasi Pratita Pratyagrushe Bhagavate Brihate Namaste. So, he is praying over here, my dear Lord. that muktaya bhuri karunaya namolayaya. My dear Lord, although I am bound, I am entangled, but please liberate me. Why should I liberate you? Because you are liberated, my dear Lord. You are muktaya. Okay, I am free, but you are bound by your own karma. Why should I liberate you? Bhuri karunaya. My dear Lord, you are so merciful. Yes, I deserve to stay bound, but you are merciful. So you are like a, you can give me amnesty, you can give me freedom because you are compassionate. But the Lord may say, I have been trying to deliver you for so long, but you have never turned toward me. Then my dear Lord, alayaya, you never get tired of delivering me. So although so many times I have turned away from you, but still you are untiringly trying to deliver me. So the idea is that it's not just that we are striving to grow spiritually and we are getting tempted and distracted. And it's like we against the world, we against the mind, we against the senses. We might feel, what can I do? But it's not like that. We are not alone. Krishna is with us. Krishna wants us to come to him. And even if we turn away from him, Krishna will again turn us toward him. He will not abandon us. And that's why, in a sense, a devotee who tries to practice bhakti and who tries to connect with Krishna even once, that person gets haunted by rasa. It's like the taste for transcendence remains and it again keeps pulling that person back. Go ahead. And then the overcoming, what happens also is that we can always continue reusing our free will. There is no conception of eternal damnation where somebody doesn't turn toward God and then that person is lost forever. No. If we don't turn toward Krishna in this life, then we can turn toward him in next life. So in that sense, the opportunities never run out. We can have a second chance and third chance and the fourth chance. So in that sense, even if we may feel, oh, so many times I tried, so many times I got deviated. If I try once again, I'll get deviated. What's the point of it all? No, keep trying. Because even if we get deviated, again we can get redirected toward Krishna. And that's the auspiciousness for us. So now this may make us complacent. Okay, if I can't do it in this life, I can do it in next life. The philosophy should be seen in such a way that it makes us more serious about our spiritual growth, not makes us more casual about it. So let's go ahead. Now, sooner or later, we will have to strengthen our intention. If we don't do it in this life, we'll have to do it in next life. And next life also is not going to happen automatically. Unless we are ready to help ourselves, even God can't help us. So God is definitely there to help us, but he can help us only when we want to and are ready to help ourselves. Only when we do our part, then Krishna will do his part. Without we doing our part, so you know, we may go for many, many lifetimes and we will never be able to turn toward him. Although that all other factors are working, it's some time or other we have to make our resolve strong. Can you go ahead? So, when we have to deal with the fear of failure, if you just focus on what is in our control, rather than worrying, oh, will I become pure enough to attain Krishna in this life? What will happen to me in the future? What if I fail? What if I get tempted? No. Just focus on what is in your control. What is in our control right now? That is, right now, I can offer my heart to Krishna. I can pray to Krishna. I can offer my bhakti to Krishna. Just do what you can right now. And what is not in our control, Krishna will take care of that. But how he will take care? Maybe he will accelerate our spiritual journey and take us to perfection in this life itself. But if it doesn't happen, then next life. So, the idea is that we should always stay focused, encouraged, and keep striving onwards. And Krishna will deliver us. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. Broadly, I spoke in three parts. The fear of failure can hold us back from doing anything in life, any and every area of our life. Fear of failure can deter us. So how do we deal with that fear of failure? By knowing that not doing will cause us greater regret than doing. And then in failure in spiritual life, we discuss three possibilities. One is that we just run out of time. Then we simply go to another life, another level, where we are born in a devotee family, and just continue from where we are left off. The second is like a student whose parents get transferred, and the student just goes to another college and continues from where they have left off and gets their degree. The second is that if somebody starts wanting to enjoy worldly things but in a pious way, then that person will go to the, it's like a student who is in university, but rather than studying, the student wants to play sports for the university. Then the studies may get suspended temporarily. The student plays sports and then come back and complete the degree. That means, a soul might go to heaven and get abundant worldly enjoyment, and then the soul comes back in either a cultured or a wealthy family, so that there are not much challenges of material life, and the soul can focus on spiritual life. And if somebody gets deviated, where they fall back away from their duties into sensuality and wrongdoing, then that will be a material consequence to their actions. Then, apart from the material consequence, the spiritual attraction will remain. That will be like the embodied knowledge, not the articulated knowledge. And after working through the material consequence, they will continue on in their spiritual journey. So the material position might be lost, but not the spiritual disposition. And for us, when we have that fear of failure, to overcome that, how can we do that? By three meditations. One is that the soul's longing for transcendence is inextinguishable. No matter how many times one might get deviated, how many conditionings we might have, but that longing is very deeply there within us, innate to us. And then it's not just we striving, Krishna's love for us is also inexhaustible. So even if we get deviated, Krishna will be with us and he will draw us to him. And lastly, even if we feel that it's going to take me a long time, well, the opportunities are interminable. But that doesn't mean we become complacent, because unless we strive to help ourselves, then God can't help us. But if we do our part, do what is in our control, in this moment, in the present, offer ourselves to Krishna, then whatever is not in our control, the challenges of future and the possibility of future failure in the future, all that Krishna will deal with us. So in this way, even if we fail, we can fail well. And not only can we fail well, Krishna says, even if we fail on the spiritual path, we fail well, and then we fare well. We fare auspiciously in our spiritual, in our future lives, in our future. So let's look at some of the questions now. How to fully forget the experience, previous experiences of the past, bad things that we have gone through? It's a gradual process. In the session on the third chapter, we discussed about overcoming self-destructive habits. And in the sixth session, we talked about the mind and how to change the impressions in the mind. So there's just to mechanically expose ourselves more and more to positive impressions. And if we keep exposing ourselves to those, then they will override the negative impressions within us. And if they keep coming, then just be patient and wait. Sometimes some impressions are deep-rooted and take some time to get over. So if some spiritual organizations offer process that is not mentioned in the Vedas, or they offer a mix of their own invention in the Vedic process, so is 640 applicable to them? Well, it depends on specifically what is being offered. Now, if there is some cultivation of transcendence through that, then that, to that extent, they will be elevated. But if there is no cultivation, there is no conception of transcendence, there is no cultivation of attraction toward transcendence. That means that if the idea is simply that you chant this mantra and then you will have your disease cured, or you will gain wealth, or you will have your daughter married, or whatever, if that is the kind of thing then they are having, then there is no transcendence in that, and that will not be what will stay with them. So it depends on whether there is a conception of transcendence and there is a cultivation of transcendence. Okay. To that extent it is there, to that extent this verse will apply. Yeah, so why did Ajamil get a chance in this life, in the same life, even though his actions were spiritually and morally degraded, whereas Bharat Maharaj were not? Yes, the point here is that Bharat Maharaj ran out of time because he had succumbed to an accident and he died. And at the time of death, he was not remembering Krishna, he was remembering just the deer. So Ajamil certainly did greater wrong than Bharat Maharaj, but somehow because of the advice of some Vaishnavas, he had named his son as Narayan, and he remembered Narayan, and he called out to his son, but as soon as he uttered the word Narayan, then he remembered the Narayan whom he had worshipped in his childhood. And thus, he became drawn towards, he said, this child Narayan can't protect me, but that Lord Narayan will protect me. And thus there was an unintentional calling out and a remembrance of Narayan. And because of that calling out, he got a chance. Now he got a chance in that life, but it was not that his sins were exempted. He had to rigorously work them through. He did severe austerities thereafter to purify himself. So what can we do if Bharat Maharaj got deviated? What about us? Well, why do we misutilize our free will? Well, that's just the conditioning or the momentum from the past. So don't worry so much about it. Just as much as we can use the free will properly, and gradually the using of the free will properly will become a habit for us. There is we have the opportunity either to focus on our weaknesses and feel that we are cursed. So the tendency to misuse our free will could be a weakness within us, or we can focus on the opportunities that we have to use our free will properly, and the inclination that we have to use our free will properly, and consider that as a blessing. So rather than focusing on whatever curses we may have in our lives, focus on the blessings and tap the blessings. So rather than worrying about too much, just try to, on a moment-to-moment basis, hour-to-hour basis, day-to-day basis, try to reorient yourself toward Krishna. And gradually that will become a habit. Don't worry so much about how often you are misusing the free will. Focus on how often you are trying to use your free will properly, and be grateful for that. Be happy about that, and try to encourage yourself through that, and then you will do that more. How do we overcome if we have natural fear, how do we overcome that and accept the higher value system of the Bhagavad Gita without any doubt? Well, it's not that we have to overcome all fear or go beyond all doubt. Just start where you are. If we have doubts, get those doubts addressed. If we have fears, address those fears. And just take small steps. Krishna doesn't expect anything unrealistic or unreasonable from us. If we have fear, well, do work within the fear. Maybe if we can't take a huge leap, then take a small step forward. Just do what we can, and our capacity to do more will be increased. If guilt of our past mistakes holds us back, well, Krishna doesn't see our past mistakes. Now, Krishna sees our present disposition primarily. Now, it is said that Krishna doesn't see what we are doing or what we have done in the past. Krishna sees what we want to do, what we long to do. So we should see, if the guilt is obstructing us, then we should see even the guilt as a temptation. The guilt, oh, I am so fallen, I am so fallen, I am so fallen, then that is also a way of being self-centered and not Krishna-centered. One way of being self-centered is, this gives me so much enjoyment, I feel so good about it. Why should I think about Krishna? But another way of being self-centered is by guilt. So just as craving can be a temptation, guilt can also be a temptation. So if the guilt is making us more discouraged in our spiritual life, then see that guilt is also an illusion, it's a temptation, and we cast aside that guilt. How do we do that? Okay, I'm fallen, but still Krishna is in my heart, and Krishna has given me an opportunity to practice spiritual life. So if I have that opportunity to practice spiritual life, and that itself is Krishna's mercy on me, let me tap this opportunity and I'll move forward. So, is it that devotees who are practicing Bhakti Yoga won't fall to animal species? Well, they won't fall to animal consciousness. They may fall to animal species. but not to animal consciousness means where there is no awareness of spirituality. But there might be a material reaction. There is a Jnananda Maharaj has written a book called Animals in Krishna Consciousness, where he has described how there across the world there are temples where devotees have experienced some animals who don't behave like animals. There's a dog in Malaysia in our temple who just come outside the temple every evening for Gaur Aarti and would sit for the time of the Aarti. There was a crocodile in a temple in Kerala was vegetarian. So the people would come to the temple not to see the deities but to see this crocodile, and then they would offer rice to the deity so that they would see the crocodile eat that rice. So we might get animal consciousness, animal body, but we won't get animal consciousness. It is said that if we forget Krishna at death, Krishna will remember us. Yes, Krishna will remember us, and Krishna remembered Bharat Maharaj also. But just because Krishna remembers us doesn't mean Krishna will override our free will. If we are attached to something, then Krishna will not force us to go somewhere where we don't want to go. If we are attached to cricket, then say for example, if we are attached to cricket and Krishna takes us to the spiritual world, then we in the spiritual world will be asking about cricket scores or stock market prices or political news, whatever. So Krishna will remember us and take us to a destination where we can process our attachments and move forward. And that's why I did for Bharat Maharaj. It's not necessary that when Krishna will remember us and take us to him. If our desire for him is not strong enough, then he won't force us to go to him. Question 8. The whole class and the last part of the class was about that. So I won't answer that again. Without any doubt and anxiety, that's the 3 points I said. Our spiritual longing is inextinguishable. Is Krishna's love for us inexhaustible? So meditate on those facts and that's how we can overcome doubts. What happens, we offend devotees? The concept of offense is not talked about in the Bhagavad Gita. So that's, I would say it's out of syllabus right now for us. But quickly I'll explain this. That generally in the time of normal interaction or service, if we speak something which hurts someone, that's not a serious offense. Circumstantially, if things happen, go wrong, we can apologize and we can clarify. It's only when we consciously try to pull down a devotee by denigrating them because of envy, that's when it's a serious offense. And serious offense will also have its consequence in terms of deviating us from the spiritual path. We'll temporarily lose our taste for Krishna, but we'll get that back in due course. Why doesn't Krishna make us forget our material longings even after that person comes to the path of bhakti? Krishna sees what we want. If we show him within our capacity that we want to remember him more and more, then that remembrance he'll give more and more. If we show him through our actions that we want still to engage in material things, that is what he will give it to us. So when if you remember the mind class, when a pop-up comes up, the pop-up may come up, but we don't have to focus on it. We don't have to zoom it further. So those pop-ups are coming up because they are tests for us. But when those pop-ups come up, whether we zoom them or not, that's our free will. So Krishna doesn't cause those pop-ups to zoom. Krishna just gives us pop-ups, and it's not so much Krishna giving the pop-ups. It is what we have chosen in the past, they come to us. And Krishna will give us purification. We just have to show him by our actions that we want that purification. So why did Krishna not make Bharat Maharaj remember him at the time of death? Well, Krishna can't make anyone remember anyone. It is remembrance is a matter of our own free will. And we have to offer our heart to Krishna. And because Bharat Maharaj was attached to the deer, so he thought of the deer. This last question is not very clear to me. This will take a long time to answer also. I will answer this in a future session about devotees facing material dangers and some distresses. That's in a later chapter when you talk about Krishna's protection, we'll discuss that. Right now, the focus was more on spiritual failure. So we are already over time. So thank you very much for your attention and participation. Hare Krishna.